A very good morning. Welcome to Suntree United Methodist Church. Good, good. And the welcome, of course, goes for those of you here in the room with me, as well as those who are watching at home in the comfort and safety of your living rooms. We're already off script. I have a feeling Annette is watching at home, probably panicked. Good morning, Annette. Anyway, I didn't just want to throw him in. Tanner is going to do the announcements this morning, but he's a new staff member, and nobody has introduced him to you, and I feel like it's sort of odd for him to introduce himself, although he will. This is Tanner Smith. He is our new Director of Communications and Media. Yes, he was hired this week by Zoom, having met the staff only virtually, and he's got a wife and a baby. The wife is from this area, Suntree. She's a public school teacher now here. She found a job. So he is quickly getting acclimated. Tanner, welcome to our happy, socially distanced family.
Yes, thank you so much. Good morning. It's so wonderful to be bringing you all in worship today. Maybe I need to step back a little bit. It might help with this mic. Just as a reminder for all of you here in person and online joining us, make sure that you check in on the website. That just lets us know who's watching, who's here with us. Think of it as that that pew kind of thing we all used to sign. But that's just a way that we know who's with us and we can celebrate together. An exciting announcement to start us off with. The rest of our staff will be joining us again on Tuesday. They have ended their quarantine. Everyone is healthy and excited to get back, and all their tests have come back negative. So we're so excited to have them with us. Yes, let's clap for that. And give thanks to God. Yes, and I personally am excited to meet my coworkers and be in a room with them and get to know a little bit more about this wonderful church. Today, our sermon will be the end of the sermon series, Teachable Moments. Pastor Joel will be kind of wrapping the whole thing up and delivering a really, I would say personally for me, challenging message from the first service when I watched it, just about Christ's call for us to look at the world and the way that we are called to live and really flip that right over, and how we're called to see the world differently and to create the kingdom of God here. So a really exciting one there. And then next week, we'll be stepping into our series on generosity, and we'll be focusing on taking the next step in gratitude. And all throughout the month of October, you'll see some things in the mail, online, all over the place that are expressing our gratitude for the things happening within the church this year and talking about our call to be generous. So keep an eye on that, and there's going to be some really amazing things coming in there. Have a great opportunity to serve coming up in a couple weeks here. Mosaic is a United Methodist congregation in Palm Bay, and every week they serve a picnic brunch to the people of their community. And a number of people come out that are experiencing poverty, that really rely on that food, and we've been given the opportunity to serve that meal with them. So all of our picnic folks, all of our brunch folks, or if you just want to get out and meet some new people, that's going to be October 4th. There is a sign-up form on the website to let us know that you're coming, to kind of claim some of the jobs and responsibilities involved, but it looks like it's going to be a really amazing service opportunity for those who are looking for a chance. Our middle school ministry, Edge, will be back in person on Wednesday night this week, and our high school ministry, Loft, will be back in person on Tuesday night. Normally on Monday night, but this week they're moving back to Tuesday. So anyone who's interested in attending those or learning more, take a look online. There's all sorts of information about both those ministries and the great things they're doing. A really cool event that I'm really excited about is called Silent Cinema, and it's going to be an evening where we present The Phantom of the Opera, and our talented organist Tom is going to play behind it, and it's just going to be a really cool way to enjoy something I've never seen, the 1925 version of The Phantom of the Opera before, so I'm really excited as a new way to kind of experience this together in person. There'll be information coming out about what that event will look like. It'll probably be similar to worship. We'll sit separate and wear masks, but that admission is free. We just ask everyone to register in advance, and then they will be collecting a donation at that evening that will go to support UMCOR, the United Methodist Committee on Relief, and all of the amazing things that they're doing around the world. So awesome chance to support a great ministry, a great part of the Methodist Church, and come enjoy a classic of cinema in a brand new way. And then another exciting thing, we are going to have a trunk or treat this year. It's going to be a drive-through trunk or treats, a little bit different than in the past, but a really safe and sanitary way that we can enjoy this season together. We can see everyone in their costumes, we can fellowship a little bit, and make sure everyone gets lots and lots of candy, because we know that's what it's all about. So that's going to be on October 24th from 5 to 7. There'll be more information coming, and there'll probably be a registration, so we know you're coming for that one as well on the website. And just a reminder, if you're going to be joining us in church next Sunday, either at the 9:30 or the 11 o'clock service, go ahead and register online. This week's that we know you're coming, we can have everything ready for you. That registration is important every week for those who will attend here in person. And now I just want to ask if we could, I don't know if we stand. No, I think we remain seated and we continue on in worship this morning. Thank you.
I sing the almighty power of God that made the mountains rise, that spread the flowing seas abroad and built the lofty skies. I sing the wisdom that ordained the sun to
morning, Century. Now you may stand for our responsive call to worship. When I'm at home, I always feel like I should stand too, but we won't know. This week has been filled with joys and sorrows.
We have come here this day with burdens on our hearts.
God, who hears your cries, will offer you healing love.
Thanks be to God for such generous compassion.
Open your hearts to God's infinite mercy.
We open our spirits to receive God's love for us.
Amen. Amen.
With many crowns.
Let's say together, please, the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated.
Good morning, Suntree. As we turn our hearts towards prayer this morning, I want to invite you, as always, to be in prayer for those folks who are listed in our bulletin. These are folks that have specifically asked for us to be remembering them in prayer, so I encourage you to do that. I also want to especially remember Marsh Jenkins, in whose memory the altar flowers were given today by his wife, Kathy. Kathy, we join you in remembering and giving thanks to God for Marsh, who passed away a year ago. We also this morning remember and pray for the over 200,000 people who have died in our country from COVID-19. We remember all of them and their families and friends, all of those who are grieving and mourning with us anywhere, all over our country and all over our world today. And finally, we also want to thank all of you for your generosity, continuing to support the ministry of Suntree Church. Your gifts truly do make a difference, and so we thank you. With that, let's go to God now in prayer. Holy God, we are so grateful for this day of worship, for a day set aside to honor you, to worship and to praise you, to be reminded of our utter dependence on you, and to thank you for your presence and your power in our lives and in the life of this world that you love so much. We pray that our worship today would glorify you and that it would draw us deeper into your loving and gracious presence. We pray that we would encounter you as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And we pray that this encounter would transform our hearts, making us more like your Son, Jesus. We admit, God, how challenged we feel by Jesus' words, by his life, his death, and his resurrection. We hear his call to forgive without limits. We hear his call to constantly be open to reconciliation with those whom we feel at odds. We hear his challenge to love as he loves, to extend grace and mercy as he extended grace and mercy. And today we hear his call to serve rather than to be served, to imitate him in his self-giving love, to imitate him in his humility, putting others first. But you know, God, that we live in a me-first kind of world. And when we are honest, we must admit that our hearts tend to pull us towards selfishness, towards the desire to win at all cost, to fight for our rights rather than to place the rights or even the basic real needs of others before our own. Forgive us, Lord, for trying to follow Christ and refusing to give up the me-first ways of the world. Cleanse our hearts of all that stands in the way of our truly embracing the heart, the mind, and the love of Christ. May His love and grace transform us so that our attitudes and our actions are more clearly reflecting what we profess to be as followers of Jesus Christ. Thank you, God, for your grace that forgives us. Thank you for your love that heals us. Thank you for all the ways that you provide for us and for every gift that you place in our hearts and in our hands. Help us, God, to be wise and generous stewards of those gifts as we use them to bless others as we have been blessed. God, we pray all of this in the name of your Son, Jesus, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
When you pass through the waters. Hey, Suntree. We will now get to enjoy a children's moment together. We, again, are so excited to continue sharing in these moments with both the adults in the room and the kids in the room and the kids at home. So wherever you're watching, enjoy this really fun and awesome kids moment with us today.
Hey, where's your new attitude?
You.
Yeah, you.
Did you forget already?
Remember?
Be unselfish.
How are you doing with that?
It's okay, we're all a work in progress.
You can't hear something once and get it, but we'll keep working on it. Maybe this will help.
Don't be selfish.
Don't try to impress others.
Be humble.
Thinking of others as better than yourselves. It's easier to be unselfish when you're being humble.
What's that?
Humble means not thinking of yourself as better than other people.
I can say that way better.
Really, dude? Not cool and not humble.
You're right. My bad, bro. Hug it out.
Okay. He lingered.
It's not about being the best, but helping others be better.
Dude, did you think of that yourself?
No, it's on the script, actually, right over there.
Oh, it's good anyway. Let's repeat that.
It's not about being the best, but helping others be better.
So what are you good at?
How can you help your friends?
Siblings.
Or the kid that not many people talk to?
Get better at what you're good at.
Just do it!
Yeah, do it now.
Boom.
Hey, Suntree. I'm so sad to not be with you again this Sunday, but I'm excited to share today's scripture with you all. The scripture passage comes from Matthew chapter 20, verses 17 through 28. So if you have your Bibles with you or your iPads or your phones, I invite you to follow along however you read scripture. The words will also be on the screen, beginning in verse 17. While Jesus was going up to Jerusalem, he took the 12 disciples aside by themselves and said to them on the way, "See, we are going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be handed over to the chief priests and the scribes, and they will condemn him to death. And they will hand him over to the Gentiles to be mocked and flogged and crucified. And on the third day, he will be raised." Then the mother of the sons of Zebedee came to him with her sons, and kneeling before him, she asked a favor of him. And he said to her, "What do you want?" She said to him, "Declare that these two sons of mine will sit, one at your right hand and one at your left, in your kingdom." But Jesus answered, "You do not know what you are asking. Are you able to drink the cup that I am about to drink?" They said to him, "We are able." He said to them, "You will indeed drink my cup, but to sit at my right hand and at my left, this is not mine to grant, but it is for those whom it has been prepared for by my Father." When the 10 heard it, they were angry with the two brothers. But Jesus called to them and said, "You know that the rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their great ones are tyrants over them. It will not be so among you. But whoever wishes to be great among you must be your servant. And whoever wishes to be first among you must be your slave. Just as the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Amen.
Okay, good morning. My name's Joel Luz. I'm the pastor of Student Family Ministries, as most of you know. And I am at home watching this like a lot of you are. If you're here live today, way to go. I'm glad you're here. We are on week 4, I think, of our series, Teachable Moments, Lessons from the Gospel of Matthew. And we're going to wrap that up. And this series is awesome because it's the scriptures. It's Jesus's words right out of Matthew. And we love to hear from Jesus. And yet these are pretty challenging words from Jesus. And this one's a tough one too. And you'll see that here as we continue along with it. The title of the message is Kingdom Reversal. And we'll unpack that as we move along and take a look at really what that means this kingdom reversal idea. To start off with, though, and this is going to be a little bit different, but I'm going to ask you a few questions. And what I'd love for you to do is turn to the person next to you. If you're at home, turn to the person next to you. If you're all alone, just kind of think about this, these questions. I'll give you a few seconds to talk about it for a few seconds, and then we'll continue. So the first question I want to ask you is this simple question. We live in Florida. What is the best city in Florida to live in? Okay, so take a minute. Turn to the person next to you or just think about it for a minute. What do you think the best city in Florida is to live in? Okay, there's a lot of great cities in Florida. Melbourne certainly is a great city. How about Orlando? Orlando's a great city. Jacksonville or Miami? Miami's way down south, right along the water. Tampa Bay is a great city. Sarasota, wonderful city, one of my favorite cities. That'd be a great city to live in. Palm Bay or Vieira, Rockledge, where I live. Okay, so next question. What is the best TV awards show on TV? The best awards show on TV. So take a second, think about that. Turn to the person next to you, tell them what you think is the best TV awards show. We have the Emmys. We have the ESPYs, the Sports Awards, the Golden Globe, the Oscars, MTV Music Awards, Country Music Awards. That was just on the other night. So what do you think is the best award show on TV? Okay, third question. What is the greatest sports team ever? I know this is a controversial one. What do you think is the greatest sports team ever? I picked three just off the top of my head. The Lakers in the NBA, Los Angeles Lakers. In football, maybe the Patriots. They've won a lot of Super Bowls, certainly as of late. Baseball, I figured the Yankees may be the greatest team ever at some point. What do you think is the greatest single team ever? Take a minute and discuss that. I didn't include hockey just because we're down here. So what do you think? Well, that's an easy one, actually. The greatest team ever is the Green Bay Packers. As you know, 13-time world champions. So I'll just give you the answer on that one. You may not agree. Okay, one more, last one. Who is or who was, either way, the greatest entertainer of all time? Who do you think the greatest entertainer is or was of all time? That's going to be a tough one. There's been a lot. So turn to the person next to you and just say, what do you think it is? Or who do you think it is? Could have been Michael Jackson, Tina Turner. If you Google Tina Turner, she's way up there. Elvis, great entertainer. Frank Sinatra, of course. Maybe Cardi B. Maybe Michael Mays. You never know who the greatest entertainer is. All right, I said that was the last one. We're going to do one more last one. Now think about this one for a minute. This is a tough one. Who do you think is currently has the most followers on social media? Who do you think today has the most, if you looked it up, the most social media followers in the whole world? Think about that for a second. Could be a movie star, a rock star. Could be just some other famous person, scientist, maybe a president. Who do you think has the most social media followers? Well, the answer to that question is a guy named Cristiano Ronaldo. Who's heard of Cristiano Ronaldo? Raise your hand. Okay, Cristiano Ronaldo is a soccer player, and he has on Facebook 135 million followers. Think about that, 135 million followers. On Instagram, he has 237 million followers. That's like larger than most countries, 237 million followers. And my daughter Willow, this morning we were talking about this, she looked it up and informed me he's now up to 238 million. He got another million, 238 million followers. I checked my Instagram followers. I'm up to 431 followers right now. So I'm feeling pretty good about that, 431 million followers, or 431 followers. All this to say is we are enamored. We are in awe. We are intrigued by fame and popularity and prestige and honor and power and things like that. That's been true all throughout humanity. It's true back in the Old and New Testament times. It's true for us today. It certainly is true for me, and I'll tell you a little bit more about that. Let me ask you a question. Have you ever sought out a person for their autograph? Have you ever gotten an autograph? Who's done that? I've done that. I've gotten autographs. I haven't done it in a long time, but I have autographs, and I got them a long time ago when I was younger, and I thought, someday I'm going to sell these and make a lot of money. I've never sold one single autograph. I got a bunch of autographs in boxes somewhere in my closet, but I've sought to get people's autographs. Why do we do that? Why do we seek people's autographs? Another question, have you ever watched people at a concert, especially young people at a concert? I mean, they're just mesmerized by the people on stage. Why is that? Because we like the awe. We like the prestige. We like the glamour of things like that. When I was in college, I went to three colleges. In my second year in college, I went to a college called Newberry College in South Carolina. And my primary, it was a small college, my primary goal there was to play basketball. Basketball was my world. It was really important to me. I loved basketball. I worked really hard at it. And I went to Newberry College in South Carolina, and I tried out for the basketball team. I had 2 weeks to try out. I worked hard at it. I trained for months, tried out for the basketball team. And the day that the coach said, here's who's going to be on the team, he listed it. And he listed 13 players, 11 of which were on scholarships, and then there were two other players on there. And he said, these two players come see me in my office. So I went with another guy. His name was Jay, I remember. And we met with the coach, and the coach kept Jay, and he cut me off the basketball team. And it was devastating. I left his office. I went to the football bleachers, to the football stadium at the college, and I went to the top of the bleachers. No one was there. It was the middle of the afternoon. I just bawled my eyes out. I just cried. I just cried and cried and cried. I couldn't believe it. I'd worked so hard. I wanted to be a basketball player. I wanted to be a star. I wanted everyone to come and watch me play. So I decided, since I didn't make the basketball team, I was going to play in the intramural basketball league at the college, and I was going to be the best player in the intramurals, and I was going to show everyone how good I was. And so I played on the intramural team, and right as we were getting close to the playoffs and championships, we had a big game, and I played in that game, and you're allowed four fouls in college. On your fifth foul, you're out of the game. And I got a foul with a couple minutes left in the game. It was a close game, got a foul, and I said, no big deal, that was my fourth foul, I still have another foul. Well, the scorer's table, where they determine all these things, said that was my fifth foul. And I said, no, I only have four fouls. They said, no, it's your fifth foul. And the ref said, if they say it, you're out. So I was out of the game. And I was devastated. And I just left. I left my team. I left the gym. I went outside. And again, I just started bawling my eyes out. And I was like, God, what's going on? Why is this happening? And I really feel like there was a point in my life where God was saying, Joel, this stuff, this desire to be a superstar, this desire to have everyone's attention and to play basketball is too important to you. And so I took it away from you. And that was a tough lesson for me. It was a great lesson looking back, but that was a tough lesson at the time. And that was the beginning of what I began to learn what this kingdom reversal thing means. And that's what we're going to talk about here for a few minutes. These are lessons from the Gospel of Matthew, and we begin with Matthew chapter 20, verse 17. Matthew writes this: while Jesus was going up to Jerusalem, he took the 12 disciples aside by themselves and said to them on the way. So immediately we know that Jesus took his 12 disciples. So he has all 12 disciples with him, and they're going to head up to Jerusalem. Doesn't necessarily mean that Jerusalem, that they were going to go up the hill. That was just a phrase back then. Just head up to Jerusalem. So they're going to go to Jerusalem. He's going to take all 12 disciples. Verse 18, he says, see, we are going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be handed over to the chief priests and scribes, and they will condemn him to death. And this is actually the third time Jesus predicts the passion, predicts his death, predicts the end of his life. He mentions that in Matthew 16, also in Matthew 17. It's his third prediction, passion prediction. Then in verse 19, Jesus says this: then they will hand him over to the Gentiles, he's referring to himself, to be mocked and flogged and crucified, and on the third day he will be raised. So it's his third passion prediction. It's the first time he's mentioned the word crucifixion. It's the first time he said, I will be crucified in this story. And what's happening here, to some degree, this is the beginning, at least to some degree, of eschatology. And eschatology is what the Bible says about the end times, the end times. And Jesus is beginning to explain to the disciples what's going to happen. So a couple things that happens here. Jesus is preparing the disciples for the end times, or for this, for the end of his life, for this crucifixion and his death and resurrection. He's starting to prepare them. So keep that in mind here for a minute. He's also, I think part of what's happening is that he's trying to show them this is part of God's plan. This is part of God's plan for me in my life, this crucifixion, this death, eventually the resurrection. And the third thing here, I think, that jumps out here, which I think is pretty fascinating, is Jesus is, he's 100% human, 100% God, 100% human, but he's not a hapless, weak human. He is willing to do this. He is going to follow through with God's plans willingly, even though it means that he's going to go to his death. And for me, I think that's really amazing. I think there's a couple of things that jump out from this story that are amazing. And the first one is that Jesus knows that he's going to die. He's going to be crucified, and he's explaining this to his disciples. Imagine knowing that. We play a game with our high school kids. The game is called Would You Rather? And we give them two scenarios. One of them is, would you rather know when you're going to die, or would you rather know how you're going to die? And we get a little discussion going with questions like that. And that's always a fun one. Well, Jesus knows both. He knows when he's going to die, and he knows how he's going to die, and he's explaining that to the disciples. I find that amazing. I also find what happens next to be pretty amazing, we'll talk about that here. Verse 20, Matthew writes this, "Then the mother of the sons of Zebedee came to him with her sons, and kneeling before him, she asked a favor of him." So these two sons are James and John, two of the disciples. So their mother pulled them aside, walked over to Jesus, and picture this, and we all have done this with God and with other people, with our spouses, with our children, with friends. She comes over and she just basically, you know, placates, you know, kneels down before Jesus and says, "Hey, listen, these are my two wonderful boys, and I have a question for you." You know, just kind of, you know, doing that with in front of Jesus. In verse 21, Matthew writes this, "And he said to her, 'Well, what do you want?' And she said to him, 'Declare that these two sons of mine will sit, one on your right hand and one on your left hand, in your kingdom.'" So again, I find that pretty much amazing. Jesus is predicting his death, his resurrection. He's trying to prepare the disciples for this. And then right in the midst of this, a mother pulls her two disciple sons and says, "Oh, by the way, when you're dead and this is all over, would you let my sons sit next to you in your kingdom?" And again, they are all about this fame and this popularity, about followers, if you will, prestige, authority, status. And this is where this kingdom reversal begins to come into play here. Verse 22, Matthew writes this, "But Jesus answered, 'You do not know what you are asking.'" Can you imagine the Son of God saying that to you? "You have no idea what you're about to ask here. Are you," and then he says, "'Are you able to drink the cup that I'm about to drink?'" In other words, are you able to do what I'm about to do? Are you able to go with me on this? Because this is going to be tough. "And they said to him, 'We are able.'" So the two disciples answered, "Yes, we're able to do this." And I think it's interesting that Jesus said that, "You do not know what you're asking." Basically, what he's saying is to reign with Jesus is to ask to suffer with him also. And they didn't get that. The disciples didn't quite understand that at that point. They were still thinking that when Jesus really gets into power, they will be in power with him. They'll oversee the whole territory, the kingdom, and they'll have power and prestige and honor and glory and all those kinds of things. And Jesus is saying, "You have no idea what you're about to get yourselves into." Verse 23, the beginning of it says, "He said to them, 'You will indeed drink my cup.'" So Jesus tells them that they will, in a sense, drink from the cup of suffering. So Jesus is saying, "Yeah, you're going to drink from the cup. Yeah, that's going to happen." And James and John, and they did suffer. Most of the disciples did suffer later on. And then the second part of that verse says, "But to sit at my right hand and at my left, this is not mine to grant, but it is for those for whom it has been prepared for by my Father." And basically what he's saying is, to sit at my right hand or my left hand is not up to me, it's up to God. It's up to my Father. I'm not going to decide that. He's going to decide that. And then verse 24, when the 10 heard it, they were angry with the two brothers. So you imagine, there's the 12 disciples. Two of the disciples' mother comes over and pulls them out and goes to Jesus and says, hey, you know, take care of my boys ahead of those guys, all right? Make sure my guys have the best two seats of honor and glory in your kingdom. I don't know what will happen to them, but that's what I want with my two boys. And, of course, that made the other 10 disciples, they were mad. They were jealous as to what was going on. They did not want to be forgotten about or dissed, put to the side. So when the 10 heard it, they were angry with the two brothers, but Jesus called them to him and said, you know that the rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their great ones are tyrants over them. So again here, this is where Jesus is beginning to shift to this kingdom reversal. He's preparing them for his death. He's preparing them for what's about to happen, but he's also saying, you know, things are going to be a little bit different. You're not quite ready for this yet. You will be, and you'll see it, but it's going to be a little bit different. Douglas Hare, an author, writes this, until their dreams of worldly grandeur, until the disciples' dreams of worldly grandeur were crushed by his execution, it was perfectly natural for Jesus' closest followers to expect that they should play some prominent role in the Messiah's kingdom. So he's saying, you know, that was just normal. They expected, as Jesus became more popular and you know, ushered in his kingdom, that they too would usher in and become more prominent. Verse 26, Matthew writes this, it will not be so among you. Again, Jesus speaking, whoever wishes to be great among you must be your servant, and whoever wishes to be first among you must be your slave. And these two words here, servant and slave, basically are saying, if you want to be my follower, if you want to be great in my kingdom, you need to be humble, you need to practice humility, and you need to serve. You need to be a servant. Humility and service. Essentially, greatness among Jesus' disciples is based on service. Okay? Greatness among Jesus' disciples is based on service. It's on this humble giving, putting others ahead of yourself, making others more important than yourself. It's not about fame and popularity and status and prestige and power and privilege. It wasn't about that then. That's what they wanted. It's not the same true today. That's what we still want. I know that's what I want. And Jesus is beginning to shift gears on them, kind of flipping things upside down, this kingdom reversal. In verse 28, Matthew says, just as the Son of Man, is quoting Jesus, just as the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many. And essentially, Jesus is the supreme example of service to others. Okay? Jesus is saying, I didn't come here to be super popular and to have this great status and prestige. I came to serve. I came to humbly serve. Dallas Willard, tremendous theologian, tremendous author, several books. I highly recommend you read Dallas Willard books. He says this, great quote. He says, the greatest issue facing the world today with all its heartbreaking needs is whether those who are identified as Christians will become disciples of Jesus Christ, learning from him how to live the life of the kingdom of the heavens into every corner of human existence. So what he's saying is, There's a movement from being a Christian to being a deeper disciple, so that following Jesus enters into every corner of your life, every part of your life, every fiber of your being. I love that quote. And that's really what kingdom reversal is. When we grow and we move and we get to that point as disciples of Jesus. Basically, part of what Jesus is saying is that the Christian life really is a life that goes against the grain. We rise above the spirit of the land, basically. And living the life that Jesus would have us live as if he were living through us, as if he were living in us. And that's what it means, this kingdom reversal. It's different than the rest of the world. We should be different than the rest of the world. J.R.W. Stott says this, if the world's shoe fits, we should be the wrong size. And that's what kingdom reversal is. So essentially, this is a tough passage. There's a lot to it, but to some degree, what he's saying is, humbly serve. Humbly serve. That's the message. Okay, BTW, there's a little bit more. And this is true of all of us, I think. This is true for me. I own this, so I'm talking about myself when I say this. To some degree, I think it can be looked at that this kingdom reversal isn't that tough, isn't that hard. Basically, Christians around the world, I think, and again, I believe this, so give me some grace here. But you know, being a Christian, to some degree, can be pretty easy. You know, you get up, you go to a Bible study. Maybe you go to a Bible study with your small group on a Tuesday night, and afterwards everyone goes to Carrabba's for dinner. You come to church and you sing worship songs. We have an amazing worship band and choir here at this church, and you just enjoy that. Maybe you do serve. Maybe you have a ministry where you go and help serve the homeless or serve food at a food bank or something like that. Maybe you get a Christian book and read that. But, you know, it's pretty comfortable in here in 2020. And I think for some of us, that kind of life, it's great. I applaud it. But it's pretty easy. But I believe, too, as you grow deeper and become more of a disciple, a deeper follower of Jesus, this kingdom reversal becomes more real, and it becomes a little bit more challenge, and it may actually, even for us here, require suffering. I don't think it's suffering, probably, perhaps here, the way the disciples or people at that time suffered, and even people who are suffering around the world today, may not quite be the same as that. But it does, I think, to some degree, it may usher in some suffering. I think as we grow as disciples with this kingdom reversal living, the world becomes a little bit different. We're in the world. We're not supposed to be of the world. And that becomes more and more clear the deeper we grow as Christians, the longer we live as Christ followers. The desire for status and prominence and prestige will decrease, I believe, in our lives. And the desire to be like Christ and the price we pay for that will increase. So our desire for this status, for this prestige, should begin to decrease as we become more like Christ. But the desire to be like Christ and the price we may have to pay in giving and suffering to some degree may increase. And that's really what kingdom reversal is all about. So think about that. Think about that in your own life. You know, has this happened for you? Are you on the road to deeper discipleship in this kingdom reversal? Do things in the world, are they starting to bother you? Are there things out there that you say, you know, I don't like that there are children who are suffering. I don't like that there's sex trafficking. I don't like that there are, I think, 1,400 homeless people in Brevard County. And that causes me pain, and I want to begin to do something about it. And that's part of what Jesus is saying. You know, don't strive to be, the top of the ladder. Don't strive for the status, for the prominence. Strive for humility and service and to be like Christ. Okay? All right, let's take a minute and we'll go to God in prayer. Let's pray. God, I thank you for these words of Jesus, and I thank you that they are challenging for us. And it's great to read Scripture and to get it and to understand it, but it's also great, God, to wrestle with the words that your Son Jesus says to us. And I pray, God, that we would wrestle with this, that we'd understand it better, perhaps go back through it a few more times, and really begin to ask the question, God, how can I live in a kingdom reversal world? How can I live in this kingdom reversal kingdom and be like your Son, Jesus? And I pray, God, that you would point that out for all of us, that you'd lead us in that, and that you would encourage us in that. And we thank you for it. Thank you that your words are challenging for us. And I pray, God, that we would all rise to the occasion and continue to grow as young disciples of your Son, Jesus. And it's in his name we pray. Amen.
Will you stand with me, please?
Thought, O words. by his hand he leadeth me. Sometimes mid scenes of deepest gloom, sometimes where Eden's flowers bloom. Still 'tis his hand that leadeth me. He leadeth me, he leadeth me. By his own hand he leadeth me. His faithful follower I would be, for by his hand he leadeth me. Lord, I would place my hand in thine, nor ever murmur nor repine, content whatever, Lord, I see, since 'tis my God that leadeth me. He leadeth me, he leadeth me, by his own hand he leadeth me. His faithful follower
task on earth is done, when by thy grace the victory's won, e'en death's cold wave I will not flee, since God through Jordan leadeth me.
And now may the love of God, the grace of his Son, Jesus Christ, and the empowering presence of the Holy Spirit go with you and be with you always. Amen.